In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. O Lord, open thou my lips. Make haste, O God, to deliver me. Like newborn infants long for pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up to salvation.
If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name.
Make known his deeds among the peoples.
Sing to them. Sing praises to him.
Tell of all his wondrous works.
Glory in his holy name. Seek the Lord and his strength.
Seek his presence continually.
Remember the wondrous works that he has done.
His miracles and his judgments he uttered.
He remembers his covenant forever.
The word that he commanded for a thousand generations.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son.
And to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning. Like newborn infants long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up to salvation.
If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good.
Please be seated for the reading of God's word.
Our first reading is written in the fifth chapter of Acts, beginning at the 29th verse. But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. When they heard this, they were enraged and wanted to kill them. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, held in honor by all the people, stood up and gave orders to put the men outside for a little while. And he said to them, "Men of Israel, take care what you are about to do with these men. For before these days, Theudas rose up claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. He was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean rose up in the days of the census and drew away some of the people after him. He too perished, and all who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or this undertaking is of man, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them. You might even be found opposing God." So they took his advice. And when they had called in the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day in the temple and from house to house, they did not cease teaching and preaching Jesus as the Christ.
But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us.
The epistle is written in the book of 1 Peter, the first chapter, beginning at the third verse. Blessed be God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls.
But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us.
Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is written in the 20th chapter of St. John, beginning at the 19th verse. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of anyone, they are forgiven. If you withhold forgiveness from anyone, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it into my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name.
But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us.
Please be seated for our sermon hymn, which is hymn 208. Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text this morning is the text from the epistle lesson from 1 Peter chapter 1. And our theme this second Sunday after Easter is your faith in your risen Lord will be tested. Please be seated. Dearest beloved of Christ Jesus, the idea of resurrection makes no sense to human reason. We do agree, though, however, that anything that dies stays dead. Only 20 years after our Lord Jesus rose from the dead, many members of a young church in a place called Corinth, which is in modern-day Greece, believed that there was no resurrection, that it wasn't possible. So then Paul wrote to them a letter, which we know as the book of 1 Corinthians, and he told them that if there is no resurrection, then Jesus did not rise from the dead. If that is the case, what a sad, sad lot we would be if Jesus had not risen from the dead. If Jesus had not risen from the dead, we would not have a Savior. We would have a dead Savior, and actually, we would have no Savior whatsoever. You and I and all people would still be in their sins, of no hope, no hope of forgiveness, no hope of heaven. Today, even today, there are many who still say that Jesus did not rise from the dead, that his body was stolen away, which makes absolutely no sense, by the way, since the tomb was sealed with a Roman seal, and to break a Roman seal meant death. Even theologians today, who supposedly know the scriptures better than you and me, they say that the resurrection was not necessary for salvation. They believe that if Jesus didn't rise from the dead, it would have no bearing on eternal life. What kind of salvation are they talking about? That's the question. What hope, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, what hope would we have? If Jesus did not rise from the dead, there is no resurrection. In faith, we believe that Jesus did rise from the dead. That this world, if Jesus had not risen, oh, it may be a nice place, and it may be a nice place to have your better life now, but if Jesus did not rise from the dead, then we are as a people to be most pitied. Paul writes to the Corinthians and says, "But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep." And that is where our Easter joy is found. That is the truth that leads us to rejoice, that with that joy unceasing, we know that one day we too will be resurrected, just as our Lord was resurrected on that first Easter morning. In Jesus Christ we are alive because Jesus is alive. He is living, and since he is living, we too will live forever with him. That is our blessed assurance. That is our hope. So we go to our text this morning, and Peter begins by saying, "Blessed be God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." We bless God the Father because everything that he desired for us and our salvation has been done for us by what Jesus has done for us at the cross and now the empty tomb. Even as life has been won for us by his Son, so also new life is yours in Jesus' resurrection. Our Father has begotten us again to a living hope by Jesus' resurrection. Begotten us again may sound a little strange to our Western ears, but it expresses a glorious truth. It tells us of a wonderful spiritual blessing that has come to each of you since Jesus has risen from the dead. To be begotten again means to be reborn, to have a rebirth. Peter is talking about a spiritual rebirth. And we have this truth told to us by Jesus. Remember there on that one evening when a Pharisee comes to him by the name of Nicodemus, and Nicodemus is wondering about Jesus and who he is. And Jesus tells him that, Nicodemus, you must be born again. We find this in John chapter 3. Jesus taught him, and he also teaches us, that this had to happen through water, baptism, and the Spirit. The Spirit works through this means of grace, holy baptism, which is the Word of God in the Gospel and in the Blessed Sacrament of baptism. This gospel is a glorious truth that Jesus has died for you, that in your baptism you have been put to death with him, and that as he has risen from the dead, so you have risen from a spiritual death to spiritual life, and all of your sins, therefore, have been taken away. The gospel also announces to us the acceptance of our Lord's death and his suffering by him being raised from the dead. God is declaring to the whole world that his sacrifice has been accepted, and therefore the entire world has been justified by this one act of justification. The gospel of your salvation is complete with a resurrected Jesus. So it is that you now have newness of life, spiritual life, by the Spirit breathing into you, into your souls, by the gospel during your baptism of a crucified and risen Savior. Yes, you are begotten. You are begotten again to a living hope. This hope is so wonderful. It is so wonderful that it's practically indescribable. Yet we humans, we treat it so poorly. We think of hope as a mere chance. I hope I don't get sick with this virus. I hope that this happens. I hope that that happens. And we're kind of rolling the dice and hoping it comes up snake eyes or not snake eyes. That's not a living hope. That is not hope whatsoever. The hope that you have in Christ Jesus, dear one, is a living hope. Jesus is living. The hope that you have is in Jesus Christ, your Lord, who was raised from death to life, just as you were raised from spiritual death to spiritual life in baptism. And as Peter tells us, Jesus is the first fruits. He is the first fruits. Afterward, those who are in Christ Jesus shall be raised to everlasting life, the everlasting glory that will happen at his coming, his second advent. You know, my dear brothers and sisters, life is not about muddling your way through this poor existence, and maybe, just maybe, if you're really lucky, if you roll the dice, if you will, if you have a hope, a worldly hope anyway, that you might make it to 80 or 90 years old. That's what the world hopes for, that's for sure. But you, dearest one, have so much more because Jesus rose from the dead, because the tomb is empty. And because the tomb is empty, you have been begotten, and it is He who has begotten you. What has He begotten you for? To an inheritance that is incorruptible and undefiled and does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Peter is telling you, and he is telling me, just how much life will be better in your and in my eternal future, which Jesus has won for each and every one of us by His death and His resurrection. You will be given, yes, my dear brother and sister, you will be given a new life there in baptism. And it is a free gift, freely given to you. You did not earn it, you did not pay for it, and you actually don't deserve it. But because of God's great mercy and grace, He has come to you, and He has put you to death in the waters of holy baptism, and have raised you to newness of life. You will therefore inherit His kingdom. That's so much better than the things of this world. So much better. Better because everything in life, as we know, everything in life in heaven will be perfect. Scripture tells us this, that we will be living in a glorious body, just as the body of our glorious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, where there is no sin, there is no tears, there is no pain, and there is no sin or death. Everything in this world, though, has been subjected to corruption. You and I know this. Everything gets old, including us. Everything wears out, including us. And eventually, everything made by man will rust away. But not your inheritance. It is being kept for you in heaven. It is being guarded for you by your Father in heaven. He's keeping your faith strong by His grace alone, and His grace solely alone, that reaches into your heart and to your soul, that works these spiritual effects in you. These are always through His means of grace, through the preached word, through the sacrament of the altar, and the sacrament of holy baptism. This is how God shows you His love for you, His grace for you. This is how He comes to you and announces to you that your sin is forgiven. Yes, Peter tells us that there will be trials and there will be temptations. What are the purpose of these trials and temptations? Well, the world wants to convince you that Jesus isn't your Savior, that He is still in the tomb somewhere in Palestine. Ultimately, the Satan, the devil, wants to rip you away from your Lord Jesus and convince you that there is no salvation. So Peter tells us that you will have trials in this world. You and I will suffer. We will be grieved, even so grieved that we want to give up. And that's what Satan wants. He wants you to give up. He wants you to renounce your faith in Jesus. We know that there's persecution going on in the world, persecution of Christians. And we know that there's even persecution happening here in the United States. Sometimes it's veiled and sometimes it's not. Maybe you have read, there are many believe right now, even today, that we Christians are responsible for this virus, for this scourge that has not only attacked us here in America, but around the world. And you're the fault, I'm the fault. That's persecution. Even so, we know that these trials that do come into our life, these are sufferings that God permits to come into our lives so that He may test us. And that testing of our faith, Peter gives us an example. And that example is the example of gold. How do we refine gold? It's stuck into the fire. And as it's stuck into the fire, it is heated to 1,100 degrees Fahrenheit. And as it's heated to that temperature, there is a sludge that appears on the top. It's called dross. And then the jeweler, the refiner, pours that dross off. And the more dross that he pours off, the more pure the gold is. That's why God sticks you into the fire. That's why he sticks me into the fire. He burns away the dross. He burns away those things in our lives that keep us from coming to him, of confessing our sins to him, of falling before him and telling the Lord, Lord, I cannot save myself because you're my Savior. I cannot do anything in your sight that is good, but your Son has. And I believe that because of what Jesus has done, my sin is forgiven. God uses these fires, these temptations, these sufferings to strengthen your faith, dear one. And as you come here to his altar, he announces to you, stand strong, stand upright, know that I have overcome the world for you. And then he nourishes you with body and blood and announces to you that your faith has been strengthened and your sin is forgiven. Today in our gospel lesson, as we now close, we heard about Thomas. Often he's called Doubting Thomas, but that's really not true. Thomas isn't doubting. Thomas is not believing. He doesn't believe that Jesus has risen from the dead. He wants to put his fingers in the holes. He wants to put his hand in Jesus' side. He will not believe unless he can handle him. And what does Jesus remind you and him? Blessed are they who have not seen and yet have believed. And Peter says, that is you. That is you, and that is me. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. My dear brother and sister, Easter does not fade away. Like some dreamy reality of some movie that is designed to strike your emotions. But Easter has changed your reality. Actually, Easter has changed everything about you. Now that you have this new birth, this living hope, an inheritance that is shielded by God in heaven for each of you by his grace, he has given you joy, even in the midst of your trials, so that through the flames of hardship and suffering and trial, you will arrive at eternity, ready to inherit all that Jesus has won for you and all that he freely gives to you, life and salvation, and yes, the forgiveness of all your sin. He is risen. Hallelujah indeed. Thanks be to Jesus. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen. Please remain standing for our canonical hymn, hymn 244.
Let us pray. Hear us, merciful Father, as we pray for ourselves, for the church, for our nation, and for all conditions and manner of people. God of mercy, keep us from the doubts and fears that cripple us and prevent us from knowing the fullness of your saving peace and gracious presence. Teach us to trust in your word and to believe with all our hearts, minds, bodies, and strength in Jesus Christ, the crucified one, who was crucified for our sins and raised for our justification. God of grace, bestow upon your church your Holy Spirit and all the gifts that come down from on high. Grant to us faithful pastors who will preach faithfully and ears to hear your word proclaimed. Give us boldness in our witness before the world and courage to speak your name without fear. God of power, give courage and strength to those persecuted for the faith and comfort the families of the martyrs. Keep your church from following the winds of change and make her steadfast in the doctrine of the apostles and the faith once delivered to the saints. Help us to admonish those who have fallen away from your word and to restore with gentleness those who have wandered from the truth. God of might, counsel the nations and their leaders in the path of peace and justice. Bless us with wise, faithful, and just leaders who will protect the sanctity of life and defend us against all enemies, foreign and domestic. Make us wise and discerning citizens who use the gift of liberty for noble purposes. God of love, teach us to love one another as you have loved us. Guide us so that in our neighborhoods and communities we may manifest the love of Christ as well as his strength. Deliver us from all that would threaten our homes and families. Protect the police, firefighters, disaster relief workers, and medical personnel who attend to us, as well as the places where we live and work. God of comfort, give your aid and relief to all who suffer want or need, to the sick in their afflictions, to those troubled in mind, and to those to whom death draws near. O Lord, this day we especially lift before your throne Esther Schweier, Jim McCullough, Aubrey Art, Sean Mendez, Austin Art, the Reverend David and Barbara Bush, Barbara Wolfert, Ryan Fiesel, Charlotte Davis, Maya Kalla, Wanda Schweier, Waylon Steiner, Janice Patterson, Kenny Miller, Patricia Lee, Jeff Secor, Nikki Strait, and Youngmin Park. O Lord, heal and sustain them according to your gracious will, and preserve them in faith to eternal life. God of hope, be with those who grieve the loss of those whom they love. Point them to the promise of the resurrection and the gift of everlasting life to all who die in Christ Jesus. Deliver us from the distractions of things that do not matter, that we may focus on the needful things of your word and sacraments, and so be found faithful when our Lord Jesus returns in his glory. God of compassion, bless us with the good gifts of the earth, with the fruits of our honest labors, and with a kind and generous heart. Accept the worship of our hearts and voices along with the tithes and offerings we bring as part of our gratitude and thanksgiving. Open our eyes and hearts to hear and to, O Lord, to see and to meet the needs of the poor, that we may serve them in your name. O blessed God and Lord, hear the prayers of your people and teach us to trust in your will, to answer our prayers with all that is needful and beneficial, both for us and for all for whom we have prayed. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Father, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings being ordered by thy governance may be righteous in thy sight. Through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end.
Bless we the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the